see how we really advance. But anyway, the four areas has been energy, risk, biodiversity, and mathematics. Today, we have the two chairmen of the steering committees of energy and risk to talk to us. Because when Future Earth came, we decided in the regional committee to create a steering committees in order to have a new approach to that area. The new approach was to really mix up social science and natural science. I don't know whether we really achieved that, but we are in the process to do it. And I would say that that's thanks to Future Earth and the work that we are doing in the region, with the help of other organizations within the region, like the Inter-American Global Change Institute. So, to begin with, we'll listen to Mr. Dr. Gassoni, that he will talk to us on the and he's the chairman of the Energy Steering Committee. He's a man from the agriculture area, so he is very keen on the question and very specialized on the question of biodiesel and sugarcane alcohol. So, bless you, please.
Okay, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, on behalf of the IGSO World Bank and Sustainable Energy team, and especially on behalf of our Sustainable Energy Steering Committee, I want to thank the organizers of the workshop Society Nature for the opportunity to present in our program. Some members of our group are also present in workshop, like our chair, Dr. Martinez, Dr. Anthony Clayton, somewhere over there, and Dr. Gabriel Blanco, somewhere too. Okay, sustainable energy is one of the priority. Energy is one of the priority programs of the IGSO-ROLAC established just after its inauguration. At that time, there were several reasons to choose sustainable energy as a priority program, and those reasons are still in place today. We can mention the ones we think are the most important. First, independent, official, and private institutions converge on their forecast that the world will demand more than 100% more energy if we compare the beginning of this decade to the stabilization of the energy demand after 2050. Second reason, the fossil fuel energy are concentrated, both geographically and economically. Renewable energy sources place opportunities for all regions and countries and constitute more decentralized value chains, meaning more equitable distribution of income and jobs, opportunities, and helping the construction of a fairer society. Third, replacing fossil fuel sources by renewable ones means more or less environment impact, especially considering the emissions of greenhouse gases and other pollutants. Recycling, energy saving, and energy efficiency are also concepts embedded on the sustainable energy framework, which largely reduce the negative environmental impact. And the fourth, in general, the use of renewable energy reduces the risks associated to energy production while taking advantage of present infrastructure. It is also important to consider that extracting energy from fossil sources involves mature technology, with higher degrees of industrial efficiency. On the other side, technologies for generating energy from renewable sources are embryonic, placing tremendous opportunities for technological improvement in terms of more efficiency and less cost, while reducing negative environmental externalities and providing access to isolated communities. On preparing the structure of the ITSU-ROLAC program and actions on sustainable energy, we developed a SWOT analysis, which identified as a major strength the leadership and recognition of ITSU connected with the need for regional integrated and coordinated actions. In spite of the ITSU-ROLAC team being composed of clever and hard-working personnel, we have to consider as a weakness that the office has a limited structure to perform operational actions. The extended team of the program, including our steering committee, is composed of professionals deeply involved with their own institutional and professional demands, which prevent them to further involve on the sustainable energy activities. We identified a set of opportunities represented by the fact that sustainable energy is on the upfront of the sustainable development. Several international agreements and regional or country public policies were set to support the expansion of the production and use of sustainable energy, energy saving, and energy efficiency. The threat is our program not advancing at the required pace, does not being the protagonist in losing the leadership. The ITSU-ROLAC program on sustainable energy is set upon the following framework. The world today faces a complex set of profound challenges on all aspects of our daily life, economics, geopolitics, or organization of the society. The future of humanity depends on our ability to find timely solutions to these problems under the umbrella of the sustainable development. Current scale and scope of this challenge requires coordinated, cross-border, and multi- and transdisciplinary research efforts. There have been many remarkable and outstanding achievements in recent years. As a result of technological progress, economic development, and political reform, people around the world are becoming healthier, wealthier, better educated, and living longer. The world is actually plenty of opportunities for a citizen to express his opinions and interfere on the proposition of public policies or even discuss the direction of technological advances. However, we still face some serious problems needing to be addressed and solved. A combination of population growth, rising demand for food, energy, water, and other resources, the degradation of key ecosystems, climate change, and the associated impacts on agricultural systems and livelihoods, in conjunction with poverty, unemployment, crime, corruptions, and failures of governance, are likely to increase the risk of violent conflicts in the future, unless these problems can be resolved. In consequence, it is essential to develop systems that can supply enough energy, food, water, and other resources for over estimated 9 billion people by 2050, without causing serious environmental damage. It is particularly important to improve efficiency in energy conversion, transportation, and consumption, as well as in energy planning and management, in order to resolve the problems of climate change while meeting the need for energy security. This is in the hard core of sustainable development. It's not easy to address these mega problems. Human, social, and economic systems are deeply interconnected with the world's ecosystems. So, it's not possible to understand or solve these problems if issues are analyzed in isolation. It is important to integrate the search for solutions and develop comprehensive strategies that can solve the world's social, economic, and environmental problems and support the transition towards more sustainable models of production and consumption. This multidimensional approach is adopted by ITSU-LAC Program on Sustainable Energy as the overarching framework for its activities, especially those selected for it World Bank. All activities to be conducted should therefore address the economic, social, environmental, and political dimensions using the best methodologies currently available for integrating these dimensions into the design, implementation, analysis, and evaluation of the problem. We strongly believe that by adopting this approach, the IXULAC will take a leading role in showing how scientific institutions can support a global transition to a more sustainable model of development, being the sustainable energy one of the major stakes. So, now let's have a glance on the main lines of actions of the sustainable energy program. We organized our program in four major lines of action. Our first line of action is research, development, demonstration, and knowledge management. The second line is capacity building. The third is outreach and advocacy. And the last one is how to finance our program. So now let's present some details of each one of these lines of action, starting with the rationale and background of research, development, demonstration, and knowledge management. So it's paramount to consider the regional energy situation. Performing an information-based analysis of the regional energy situation and its needs as a starting point from any other action. It is necessary to perform a data collection and set database management activities related to sustainable energy. Actions must be on the framework of integrated inter- and transdisciplinary research on sustainable energy, with relevant sectors and stakeholders such as government, national and local, private sector, media, and civil society organizations. We recognize the importance of cooperative efforts with the sustainable energy programs from other IXU regional offices when requested, as well as support regional initiatives for the IXU agenda on sustainable energy. It is necessary to perform an identification of research topics that need interdisciplinary and international cooperation on the region. And finally, it is needed a definition of the appropriate guidelines and the criteria to evaluate, rank, and select research projects on sustainable energy on our region. And the most important objectives associated with this line of actions are: first, identification of research topics important for the region that need interdisciplinary and international cooperation. Second, promotion of integrated inter- and transdisciplinary RDND on sustainable energy with relevant sectors and stakeholders such as government, private sector, media, and civil society organizations. And the promotion of the collaboration among the sustainable energy programs from other IXU regional office and any regional initiatives related to the IXU agenda on sustainable energy. The activities under the defined framework and objectives of this line are: first, analysis and assessment on regional energy situation needs and information-based analysis of the regional energy situation and needs. Development of methodologies to define and evaluate externalities on all dimensions of sustainability regarding the production and use of energy. Third, database management and knowledge management related to sustainable energy, including: first, identification of existing database and research groups and networks, and second, development of a virtual platform to manage a database of public access, maintaining it permanently updated. And finally, collaborative actions between IXU and research groups and networks on sustainable energy. Then the second line of action is capacity building. The rationale and background associated is the establishment of regional leads in terms of capacity building in connection with sustainable energy at all levels of formal education. specially identify the needs for capacity building for high quality integrated inter and transdisciplinary research, development and application on sustainable energy in the region. Strong connection with sustainable energy programs from other IGSU regional offices, as well as other initiatives regarding the IGSU agenda on sustainable energy. Support actions regarding sustainable energy, education and awareness, multi-stakeholder feedback into sectoral research. We need to invest on training of trainers, including university professors, consultants, and other specialists. And finally, we have to promote the exchange of researchers, students, trainers, and specialists between regional institutions. Then, the objectives associated with capacity building are identification of regional needs in terms of capacity building in connection with sustainable energy at all levels and all topics. Second, identification of regional needs in terms of capacity building for integrated inter- and transdisciplinary research, development, and applications on sustainable energy in Latin America and the Caribbean. Three, definition of integrative programs to work effectively in interdisciplinary teams like training of trainers. And last one, the establishment of programs to exchange researchers, students, trainers, and specialists. The activities of this line of action under the defined framework and objectives are analysis and assessment on regional needs of capacity building related to sustainable energy at all levels of education, I mean basic, medium, and bachelor, technical, professional, and scientific levels, and on topics like technical, environmental, political, etc. To develop the Latin American and Caribbean skills inventory, it is necessary to conduct a survey on the most important Latin American and Caribbean universities and research institutes dealing with sustainable energy. Developing a new integrative program to train people to work more effectively in interdisciplinary teams. Development of programs to exchange researchers, students, trainers, and specialists to advance and promote the science and technology on a sustainable energy ground. So, the third line of action is outreach and advocacy, based on the following rationale and background. First, organization of conference, capacity building, follow-up, and outreach activities. Second, the advocacy for integrated RD&D on sustainable energy. Integrate and support sustainable energy programs on other IGSU regional offices and the regional initiatives for the IGSU agenda on the subject. Communication with policymakers and public policies regarding sustainable energy development. Communication to research funding agency and donors. And cooperation among the IGSU international unions, IGSU members and other organizations on interdisciplinary issues on sustainable energy. Now, the main objectives of this line of action are, first, dissemination of scientific and technical knowledge and engineering best practices related to sustainable energy, dissemination of information among members of the scientific community, policymakers, and the general public about the risks of delaying a transition to a sustainable energy system, promotion of the importance of sustainable energy development among policymakers, stakeholders, and the general public, and the promotion of the benefits of humankind in the event of change into a sustainable energy system. The major activities under the defined framework and objectives are, first, developing of a comprehensive program for the dissemination of knowledge about sustainable energy in the scientific community and the general public, and regarding the risks to humanity of deferring decisions and actions towards transition to a sustainable energy system. Development of a cross-border programs to transfer knowledge and experience of public policies on sustainable energy development to policymakers, provide further support and endorsement to local or regional RDND projects yet in place, provided that they comply with the set IPSU framework in order to achieve high quality, cross-border collaboration, transdisciplinary and policy relevance. Collaborative actions between IPSU and scientific associations and networks related to sustainable energy. And specific cooperation among IANAS and IPSU ROLAC on developing a program with relevant institutions in order to reduce illiteracy of scientific and technical knowledge and engineering best practices related to sustainable energy, dissemination of information among members of the scientific community, policymakers, and the general public about the risks of delaying a transition to a sustainable energy system, promotion of the importance of sustainable energy development among policymakers, stakeholders, and the general public, and the promotion of the benefits of humankind in the event of changing to a sustainable energy system. The major activities under the defined framework and objectives are, first, developing of a comprehensive program for the dissemination of knowledge about sustainable energy in the scientific community and the general public, and regarding the risks to humanity of deferring decisions and actions towards transition to a sustainable energy system. Development of a cross-border programs to transfer knowledge and experience of public policies on sustainable energy development to policymakers. Provide further support and endorsement to local or regional RDND projects yet in place, provided that they comply with the set IPSU framework in order to achieve high quality, cross-border collaboration, transdisciplinary, and policy relevance. Collaborative actions between IPSU and scientific associations and networks related to sustainable energy. And specific cooperation among IANAS and IPSU ROLAC on developing a program with relevant institutions in order to reduce electricity stealing in poor communities by promoting the development, manufacturing, and adoption of energy-saving appliances for low-income families. And finally, the last line of action is to provide financing and fundraising to support the sustainable energy program. The main objectives associated to this line of action are: identify the costs associated with the activities of IPSU ROLAC program related to sustainable energy, either for a short term, 1 year, and medium term, 5 years. Develop funding application to get reserves from grants and donors. Develop programs of training course by specialists that are self-financing. The activities under this line of action are: develop a comprehensive program including costs of the IPSU ROLAC sustainable energy activities. Survey the Latin American Caribbean University and Research Institutes. Also develop the Latin American Caribbean skills inventory associated with the ROLAC sustainable energy program. Do gap analysis. Identify critical skills gaps, social, economic, and political constraints, missing infrastructure. Identify which are the most significant impediment to progress in this segment. Develop proposal for resolving the most significant problems. Some of these will relate specifically to capacity, like skills shortages, or there will be policy proposals or relate to research or teaching programs. And finally, establishment of an agreed coordinated joint program among the major national science agencies in Latin America and Caribbean to fund and support collaborative projects for conducting integrated research on sustainable energy at the regional level. So you can see an example regarding this line of action, as the ROLAC just submitted its contribution to the IPSU proposal for SIDA, the Swedish funding agency, which includes the activities of the Sustainable Energy Program. So, Mr. Chair, ladies and gentlemen, this is an overview of the present status of the sustainable energy program of Ixu-Rulek. As you could observe, the program on sustainable energy takes into consideration the interface of the technological development and social environmental aspect of sustainable energy generation. Thank you very much for your attention.
This morning I'm going to very briefly have a look at the contribution of the Ixu-Rulek, that regional office for Latin America and the Caribbean, its science plan, and how this will contribute, hopefully, to disaster risk reduction in Latin America and the Caribbean. Reducing disaster risk really can only be achieved if we truly understand the interaction between nature and society. And to my mind, and this is my personal opinion, the hazard really is man. We need to understand man as hazard to truly succeed in disaster risk reduction. So the official name of the plan is Understanding and Managing Risk Associated with Natural Hazards, a comprehensive scientific approach to Latin America and the Caribbean. It was put together in 2010 by the Ixu Scientific Planning Group, made up of many scientists from Latin America and the Caribbean region. It's really based on the premise that risk is the result of interaction in time and space of physical events, exposed and vulnerable elements of social and environmental systems. And it is in creating this exposure and vulnerability that I see man as the true hazard. The DRR, disaster risk reduction, will require complex interactions with application of all types of science, knowledge, and methods. And this is where we continue this theme of interdisciplinary research and the collaboration among science and technical aspects, because of course we can't forget engineering and so on as we talk about disaster risk reduction. Now, the overall goal of the plan is really contributing to more effective understanding of disaster risk and disaster risk management, DRM, in Latin America and the Caribbean, while promoting this comprehensive interdisciplinary framework. And as one committee member said, we're not talking about multidisciplinary, we're talking about interdisciplinary. So it's not people working in their little silos, bringing each of the silo to bear on a problem. It's a true eradication of disciplinary boundaries coming together to solve problems for the benefit of society. And the scope in terms of hazards is practically everything: mitigation, which is also called risk reduction, prevention, preparedness, and response and recovery. And included are also the secondary effects of hazards. So we would also continue complex situations, such as that which obtained after the 2004 tsunami, where the natural hazard had an impact, which then led to cascading effects, including technological hazards. The plan outlined some priority research areas. Small towns and villages should benefit from hazard mapping and the integration of disaster risk reduction into planning. And this is important because we keep on hitting a barrier when it comes to scale very often in disaster risk reduction. There are many programs of risk analysis and risk mapping which are aimed at the level of a town or a county. Very few programs actually apply science to the community level scale. So it's very important that we look at the small towns and the villages where much of the risk is concentrated. Also towards better hillside construction and risk reduction efforts. We know, particularly for small countries, that topography is a real problem when it comes to managing risk. If you are a very small landmass with steep mountains, close to your shoreline, then find what one would call a safe or a low risk area is extremely difficult. Add to that, if you have volcanoes and earthquakes as part of the mix, then you're really facing problems. Then data collection and sharing. This topic always comes up in meetings in the Insular Caribbean. The collection of data, its management and sharing continues to be problematic. So I'm really happy to see that the plan addresses this as well. Disaster risk modeling platforms are part of it. Application of indicators at the sub-national level. Again, there are many countries which apply disaster risk management indicators at national level. We need to take it down to regional within the country and also sectoral levels to truly map progress in disaster risk management. Then the whole matter of climate change adaptation. Can we apply the long history of lessons from disaster risk reduction to climate change adaptation? And you will recognize that a very large part of climate change adaptation really has to do with adapting to the changes in the nature of impact of hazards in the future. Then, what drives decision-making processes at national, regional, and local levels? Why is it that despite all we know about hazards, despite all we know about risk reduction, that we continue to increase exposure? Losses from natural hazard impacts continue to increase despite the availability of this knowledge. Is this knowledge being adequately, efficiently, and properly integrated into decision-making processes? So that is another area which will be examined. Now, some of the specific goals of the plan: promotion of adequate and comprehensive decision-making processes. So that will tell you that the political and policy level are important as part of this. Integration of disaster risk reduction and climate change adaptation. Development and promotion of methods, methodologies, for the integration of the social and natural sciences into interdisciplinary research protocols. So can we actually come together and have common protocols between the sciences? And then how do we transition between research and action? How do we ensure that our research and the results of our research is incorporated into action which results in disaster risk reduction? And we are here including participatory research as part of the method. Now, a little bit about the Disaster Risk Reduction Committee. It was established in September 2013 and had the first meeting later that year. The work of the committee, as for the Energy Committee, is guided by the overall regional plan, in our case by the science plan. And within that framework, there are certain guiding principles for the work of the committee. And these were discussed at our first meeting last year. So our methods and protocols must encourage interdisciplinary work, is one principle. We must engage in social communication to allow effective incorporation of science into that disaster risk reduction at all levels. And we come back here to the matter of scale, not just at regional or national level, but also at local level. And then, encouragement of wide stakeholder participation. All of society must participate in disaster risk reduction. And if science is to be integrated into disaster risk reduction, it must be integrated so that all of society can understand it. So those are three guiding principles underlying the work of the committee. Now, what has happened so far? Well, we had our initial meeting last year. Our second meeting is planned for later this year. The committee thought it was important to know the current status of research in disaster risk reduction across the region. the sources of funding and also what gaps there may be in research needs. So there was commissioning of this analysis. And this study should be completed later this year. And the results should help to further define the research agenda going forward. The committee has also been heavily involved in the promotion of the inclusion of science in the Global Disaster Risk Reduction Agreement, HFA2. And we do that by supporting the ICSU-led major science group. And as background to this, it was thought that the sciences are not sufficiently represented in the Global Framework Agreement on Disaster Risk Reduction. The old framework was called the Hyogo Framework for Action 1. The successor so far is being called HFA2. So we have been on a campaign led by ICSU at a global level to have science more visible in the successor framework agreement. So far, there have been some successes. Statements from the Regional Disaster Risk Reduction Platform, which was held in Ecuador, and the preparatory committee meetings held in Geneva earlier this year, called for greater inclusion of science in HFA2. And very importantly, it's calling for the establishment of a global science mechanism to support disaster risk reduction in countries which sign on to HFA2. So these discussions are ongoing, and hopefully the result will be seen in the new agreement, which will be discussed at the World Conference on Disaster Risk Reduction next year in Sendai. For the future, well, the committee can very much build on current initiatives ongoing in the region. In the area of data collection and sharing, which you remember was mentioned earlier, then there are several countries in Latin America and the Caribbean using the DESINVENTAR database for tracking the impact of hazards. DESINVENTAR allows you to track the impact of very localized events, which, when they accumulate, cause a major impact to the country. And the database uses socioeconomic and human impact data as part of its calculation. We talked about hillsides. Jamaica recently launched a hillside development in Bangalore, and there's an opportunity here for sharing experiences as we move forward. Disaster risk management indicators, originally developed in Colombia, and this is Colombia, South America, are being used in the Caribbean. And these indicators use a suite of data, demographic, socioeconomic, physical, and so on, for calculation. Consistent use of these indicators allows you to track how a country is doing in various aspects of disaster risk management. And you will recall, we said that we wanted to promote the use of these indicators beyond national level, down to localized level. Then, when it comes to disaster risk reduction and climate change adaptation, these two topics are integrated into the regional disaster risk management strategy for the Caribbean, called Comprehensive Disaster Management. And there is also a tool called Sea Coral, developed by the Caribbean Climate Center, which looks at integrating climate change adaptation and disaster risk reduction into planning and programming. So this is a very important initiative, I think, which we could expand as we go forward. Then the whole matter of probabilistic risk assessment. A tool called CAPRA, or a method, was developed in Central America for probabilistic risk assessment. This has now been extended to the Caribbean, and many countries in the Caribbean are using this method. So we are looking here not only of sharing of the method, but perhaps eventually at standardizing probabilistic risk assessment if we all can agree on the use of a common tool. Then this whole matter of data collection and sharing, there's an open access platform called GeoNode, which can be used for storing display and access of data, including spatial risk data information maps. It's being used and introduced in the Caribbean as well as in Latin America. And as an example of that, we have here a site run by the University of the West Indies. And this site displays risk information for three Caribbean countries for the seismic hazard and the flood hazard. And it's actually based on this open access platform called GeoNode. So anyone can access the site and look at the information. There are certain restrictions. To alter data on the site, you have to be one of the scientists who is working on the project. So you can upload data if you're a scientist. If you're a member of the public, you can access the data to look at it, but you can't actually manipulate it. And for the future, in terms of connecting, the agency formerly known as CEDA Canada, now known as DFAT-E, has funded a project at UWI, which includes establishing a portal. It's yet to be defined, this portal, but conceptually, we are hoping it will provide a gateway or a hub for DRR networks and databases, initially in the region, and then perhaps going beyond the region. It will be publicly accessible. In other words, again, all of society should have access. One of the benefits of such a portal is that for the ordinary person, it's very difficult to know where to go to find reliable information on disaster risk reduction and disaster risk management. This portal should provide one location where a normal citizen of any country in the region can go and be introduced to different sites for different aspects of disaster risk reduction and disaster risk management. Opportunities for the Disaster Risk Reduction Committee. I think this committee is an excellent idea, being across the region as it is, all of Latin America and the Caribbean. And some of the opportunities, we have an opportunity to develop and maintain a critical mass of regional scientists working on disaster risk reduction and dedicated to the integrated research approach. And this, I think, is extremely critical because not only do we face disciplinary silos, we also face national silos. We're all in our little countries working, not working across boundaries, so that's important. Undertake interdisciplinary and transboundary research. Currently, in the Anglophone Caribbean, we tend to collaborate with universities in the north, generally, whether it be in the USA, Canada, the UK, and so on. And perhaps that is because Anglophones are notoriously lazy in learning other languages. And I do a mea culpa as an Anglophone myself. This committee presents the opportunity for us to go beyond that, to have South-South collaboration, I speak now geographically, with many universities in Latin America. Because of the commonalities in exposure, the commonalities in vulnerability across the region. So countries would benefit from more collaboration and exchange of experiences and so on. Also, an opportunity to advocate for coherent DRR research agenda at sub-regional and national levels. Certainly at national level, we don't tend to develop a national research agenda, which is going to then inform policy and programming. So this is something we could look at. Could the sub-regions of Latin America and the Caribbean develop a common research agenda, which would encourage synergistic approaches, including those for disaster risk reduction and climate change adaptation. And then also the opportunity to promote exchanges, data, skills, knowledge, and experiences. And finally, a big opportunity to support and promote science for and in disaster risk reduction and climate change adaptation. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is my presentation. Thank you.